A very warm good morning to all of you. Dear students, once again, I would like to welcome all of you to a new session of the history class. Today, we are continuing with the same chapter from history, chapter number 13, United Nations, part 5. With this part, we are going to wind up this chapter. We are going to complete the chapter, United Nations. Before we move to the chapter, let me ask you, do you remember what we were discussing in the last class? In the last class, we were discussing about International Court of Justice and its composition. What is International Court of Justice and how it is being formed? So these were the things which we were discussing in the last class. And today we are going to discuss, or we are going to deal with, powers and functions of International Court of Justice. Something further about International Court of Justice. What are their powers and how they function? So without wasting time, let's move to the class. Powers and functions of International Court of Justice. It has got divided into seven different factors or seven different parts. First one, the parties. Who can approach the International Court of Justice? Second one, source of applicable law. Third one, voluntary jurisdiction of International Court of Justice. Fourth one, compulsory jurisdiction of International Court of Justice. Fifth one, advisory opinions of International Court of Justice. Sixth one is codification of international law. And the seventh one is evolving procedures for peaceful settlement of disputes. So these are the seven different criteria which will explain what are the powers and functions of International Court of Justice. Now we are going to discuss each one of these points in detail. First one, the parties. Only member state can apply for or appear before the court, which means if a country is the member of United Nations, those countries only can appear before the International Court of Justice for their or for solving their problems. So only member state, the state which is the member of United Nations, only can apply or appear before the Court of International Justice. Second one is sources of applicable law. International Court of Justice decides the cases according to certain criteria. It is on the basis of international treaties, then conventions in force, then international customs, then general principles of law, then juridical decisions of qualified publicists. Which means, if the International Court of Justice has to make a verdict, it will be discussing or it will be considering international treaties, because nowadays all the different nations are making number of treaties. Britain is making number of treaties with America. America is making number of treaties and different kinds of dealings with other countries. So international treaties, then conventions in force. What were the different conventions which are still remains as a valid treaty between nations? Then international customs. There are certain customs between the countries or states, general principles of law. So all these things will be considered by the International Court of Justice, and on the basis of that, they are making decisions. Sources of applicable law is on the basis of the decisions made by the International Court of Justice, which will be getting the supports of different criteria like international treaties, conventions in force, international customs, and so on. Now, voluntary jurisdiction. It is competent to hear a dispute if the states concerned agree. Which means, suppose two countries are there, they are in a problem, they are fighting each other. So in those cases, they can take it to the International Court of Justice. If the states concerned agree, which means If both the states are agreeing that the International Court of Justice will provide them justice properly, then only it can take up the case. That's voluntary jurisdiction. And next one is compulsory jurisdiction, which means when a large number of treaties provide disputes that are submitted to it. Suppose if there are a number of countries who have deal with a number of treaties, not just one, two or three, but a number of treaties were there between a number of states, and those cases came to be, or those cases are submitted to the International Court of Justice. In those cases, it will be coming under the compulsory jurisdiction of the International Court of Justice. Disputes because of interpretation of international law. Each country is following its own rules and regulation. I have already told you certain points regarding to this particular topic. A law will be practicable only in that particular country. For the best example, Arab nations are following their own rules and regulations, and it is entirely different from the other democratic countries. The different capital punishments are given by the Arab nations cannot be justified in a democratic country. So rules and regulation will be varied from nation to nation. So disputes because of interpretation of international law will be coming under the compulsory jurisdiction of the United Nations, especially International Court of Justice. Then reparation, which means compensation to be made for the breach of the international obligation. Suppose a country has made a treaty with one another country and they violate it. Suppose if France agreed to provide coal to one another nation, and after 5 years of the treaty they have violated it because they were not ready to provide coal to the particular country. So it will be a violation to the treaty. In those cases, compensation to be made for the breach of international obligation. So it will be a violation of the treaty, or it will be a violation of the obligation according to the international treaty. So in those cases, those kinds of cases will be coming under the compulsory jurisdiction of the International Court of Justice. Next one is advisory jurisdiction. Opinion to all international organizations. Number of international organizations are there, and it is the responsibility, or it is the duty of International Court of Justice to provide advisory to all international organizations. If it is a national organization, or if it is an organization which is functioning inside a particular country, this particular advisory jurisdiction will not be applicable for them. But if it is functioning internationally, it is the responsibility of International Court of Justice to provide advisory jurisdiction to all those organizations, especially to 5 different organs of United Nations. United Nations has got 6 different organs, including International Court of Justice. Except International Court of Justice, 5 different organs are say, especially including General Assembly and Security Councils. So these 2 different organs, which we have already discussed in the previous class, are also coming under the International Court of Justice. International Court of Justice will be providing enough advice to all the different 5 organs of United Nations. Then 16 specialized agencies of United Nations. United Nations having number of agencies, and 16 specialized agencies are getting different advices from International Court of Justice for its smooth functioning. Then codification of international law examines the international conventions, customs, judicial decisions and general principles. So the International Court of Justice will be always examines the international conventions, different gatherings and meetings of the different nations, maybe number of countries together or two or three countries alone, then customs, different customs and traditions followed by number of countries, then judicial decisions made by those countries and general principles are followed by number of states. All those things will be considered by the International Court of Justice, and they will be making rules and regulations. They are creating number of rules and regulations after the codifications of all those verdicts and rules and regulations made by the number of states, and it will become the international law. Procedure for peaceful settlement. It's one another important responsibility or the functions of International Court of Justice, because they also have an important role in the procedure for peaceful settlement. Recommend appropriate procedure or methods, because the judges of International Court of Justice will be qualified to make enough comments, or they will be able enough to make verdicts which can helpful or which can be functioned as a barricade to the threat of international peace. So make or apply, recommend appropriate procedure or methods which will be the threats to the peaceful settlement of case. Then decision is made by majority of judges present. We have already seen in the International Court of Justice 15 judges will be there, 15 representatives will be there. So a decision on a case or on a situation will be made by majority of judges present. Member state is obliged to stay with a decision of the court. So the court will be making a decision, and it is the responsibility or it's the duty of the state to follow the decision or the verdict made by the International Court of Justice. If any party doesn't stay with the decision, the other party can take the matter to the Security Council. Suppose if there is a problem between two states, both are the members of United Nations. So the International Court of Justice has made a verdict, and if one of the country was not happy with the decision of the International Court of Justice, they can take the matter to the Security Council, where they can expect a better justice. So these are the different powers and functions of the International Court of Justice. So dear students, with this we are winding up this chapter. In the next class, we will be dealing with the next chapter from history. So, still then, I would like to sign off. Thank you.